West Australians will be heading to the polls next Saturday, with WA Premier Mark McGowan widely expected to stay in power.
Prime Minister Scott Morrison said he won't be heading west to support the Liberal campaign, despite fears of a landslide win for Labor. Joshua Zimmerman is the state political reporter for the West Australian, and he joins us now. Good morning to you, Joshua. Is this election already won and lost?
I think many people would say the election is already won for Mark McGowan, yes. Pre-poll started about 10 days ago. 330,000 people have already voted. If you believe the polls, more than two-thirds of those people will have voted for the Labor Premier. And in fact, about a week ago, we had the opposition leader, Zach Kirkup, come out and effectively concede the election, saying that there was no chance of winning, that the Liberals wouldn't form government, and completely pivoting his campaign messaging to warn against Labor getting total control of Parliament, by which he means majority in both the upper and lower houses, which would effectively allow the Labor government to pass legislation unopposed without any checks or balances.
Yeah, I think that was a really interesting move from Zach Kirkup. Was that a strategic move then?
Oh, absolutely. He came out, well, I mean, he was installed as the opposition leader only about 3 months ago, replacing Lisa Harvey. And he initially spoke about wanting to engage in a contest of ideas and talk about unveiling policies every day in the run-up to the election, which he did. His problem, though, was that none of those policies got much cut through. And he's also up against an immensely popular premier in Mark McGowan, who has been rewarded, I guess, by voters for how he's handled the coronavirus pandemic. Western Australia's come through that largely unscathed. Obviously, it's been the massive issue dominating headlines for the past year. And so it's front of mind for voters. This was always going to be an election framed around coronavirus, I think, and that obviously plays in Mr. McGowan's favour.
Yeah, I think the rest of the country would be very aware that Western Australia has had a very strict border policy. And while people outside of WA might have been frustrated by those border policies, it seems to have been a real vote winner for people within WA.
Absolutely. Survey after survey has shown strong support within Western Australia for how the state has handled coronavirus, and much of that is based on this hard border policy. Just the other day, latest survey results came out state by state showing support for response to coronavirus, and Western Australia was on the top of the list. 80% of people think that the state government has done either a good or very good job in handling COVID. And that's all down to the hard border, which McGowan talks about at every opportunity.
Although it seems as though Mark McGowan has stepped a bit further over the line and had to walk back some comments about extending the state's controlled border beyond COVID-19 in order to slow drug importation. Where did he land on that policy?
Yeah, so that was an interesting blunder, I guess you could say, from McGowan. And it came shortly after Kirkup started talking about the dangers of Labor getting total control of Parliament. A few days later, Mark McGowan held a press conference where he was speaking about how the hard border had done a great job stopping COVID from getting into the state, but also meth. And said that he was speaking with our police commissioner about keeping some of the border restrictions in place beyond the pandemic. By that, he initially meant keeping police on the land border entry checkpoints to check people for drugs as they were crossing the border. But he was asked at that press conference if those border restrictions could extend to keeping the GTG pass system in place, which is essentially a visa that interstate travellers need to get before they can come to WA. And the Premier three times refused to rule out keeping the GTG system in place. That was quickly seized upon by Kirkup as an example of immense overreach, in his words, by the Labor Premier. And just a few hours later, at another press conference, McGowan wound those comments back, definitively stating that the G2G pass would not continue beyond the pandemic.
Now, as we mentioned in the introduction, there's not that much federal support for this state election. Scott Morrison is not visiting the West. Anthony Albanese, he was in the West, but I understand that he met with Mark McGowan behind closed doors and there was no sort of public event. Does the fact that there isn't much federal support matter in this election?
Certainly not for Mark McGowan. It was clearly a choice by the WA Labor campaign not to appear alongside Anthony Albanese. You're right, he was here yesterday and the day before that. In fact, on the day that he arrived, our Premier bolted down south 150 kilometres away from where Anthony Albanese was. Yesterday, the two of them did meet face-to-face, but behind closed doors. There was no public appearance. In terms of Scott Morrison not coming over, that probably has done a little bit of damage to Zach Kirkup's campaign. Morrison is popular in Western Australia. It's a state that votes overwhelmingly Conservative at a federal level. Although, to be fair, Zach Kirkham's campaign is so far behind at this stage that it probably wouldn't have made too much of a difference.
Just finally, I also wanted to touch on Crown and the WA government announcing a royal commission will be examining Crown's suitability to run its casino at Burswood. This comes after, of course, the Bergen inquiry. How significant is this in WA?
Oh, it's massively significant. We had a Royal Commission announced yesterday. It's the first Royal Commission we've had here in WA in nearly 20 years. It follows on, obviously, from the Bergen inquiry, as you mentioned. Melbourne or the Victorian government has also announced a Royal Commission into Crown's operations in that state. What's significant about the West Australian version is that our Royal Commission is going to look at both Crown's suitability to hold a casino license, but also the role of our casino regulator over here. During the Bergen inquiry, revelations of money laundering came to long running, going on for nearly a decade. And obviously, our casino regulator completely failed to pick up on that. So there's a possibility of the entire act, I guess, that underlines the casino operations here being rewritten. And there's also a possibility that Crown will have its license stripped.
Joshua Zimmerman from the West Australian. I'm sure you've got a very busy week ahead of you, but thanks for joining us this morning.
No worries. Thanks for having me on.